the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. May the Lord bestow His grace and mercy upon all of us. Amen.
The gospel of this morning is one that is familiar to most of us. Christ is in Capernaum, He is at the house, and it appears that whenever He was in Capernaum, He was at one specific place. There is a definitive region here. There's a specific house that He is at. And people come to Him, including those who are carrying the man who is paralyzed. We see that within this crowd, there are people there for very different reasons, for many reasons. Some are there for Christ, others there for to criticize Christ. For those who are carrying the man, however, those who are carrying their friend, those who are carrying the paralytic, there's one clear purpose. They are carrying their friend to be healed by Christ. There is a single purpose here for them. Now for us, it's very easy to, this is one of the easier gospels to read because it starts off with Christ being in the house and they are going to meet Him. We know where the house of God is. We're in it right now. We've come to meet Him. So many ways we can very easily associate with what is happening in this gospel. But one of the first things we have to keep in mind and ask ourselves is, why are we here? For them, it was clear. For those four men carrying their friend, it is to come to see Christ. But why are we here? It is not uncommon that we hear people say, well, I go to church, but I don't quite feel anything. I go to church every week, but it feels kind of empty in a way. The same hymns, the same thing. I'm trying, but I go, but I don't really benefit much. And yet, in the Gospels, we are told explicitly by Christ, seek and you will find. How is it that we can come and not receive anything? And yet, Christ tells us, assures us, that if we seek, we will find. I don't think there's much of a mystery here. You basically find what you seek. It's almost like going to a trip to New York. Go to a trip to New York, you ask, somebody will ask you, well, did you see the Statue of Liberty? And you could tell them, no, I was going there for a conference, I was going there for a convention, I was going there to see family. I was in New York, but I didn't see the Statue of Liberty. This is opposed to planning a trip to New York in order to see the Statue of Liberty. If your purpose in going to New York is to see the Statue of Liberty, you're going to see the Statue of Liberty. Now, you may see family on the East Coast. You may go to Times Square. You may go to Central Park. And all that is fine. But if your trip is to go and see the Statue of Liberty, you're going to plan everything around that aspect of your trip. Often we come to church, but it becomes routine. It becomes, this is what we do on Sunday. We go, we see our friends, we see our family, we see our support network. We might see Christ, we might meet Him, we might hear something, but what is the purpose of the trip and what is incidental becomes somewhat confused. We have to have this clarity of aim, this clarity of purpose. Yes, I may see my friends, I may see my family. Yes, I enjoy going to church. They make great coffee. But my purpose is first and foremost that I am there to see Christ, that I am meeting Christ. When we look at the four men and their paralytic friend, see that they encounter a crowd. They encounter a crowd, but then that does not deter them. One of the things that we have to contend with in life are crowds. Now, sometimes they're physical crowds. Not this morning. We got plenty of elbow room this morning. Some cases we have to deal with actual crowds. Most of the times our crowds are things that really occupy our mind more than crowd our bodies. We have to have this same attitude, this same single-mindedness that these four men had. It's crowded, they couldn't get to Christ, but they didn't call it a day. They could have just as easily said, well, we came, we tried. Too big of a crowd. There's no way we can possibly get in there to see Christ. Let's head back home. Nobody would have really blamed them. They went through the effort. They loved their friend, clearly. But they didn't let a small thing like a crowd get in their way. That obstacle wasn't enough for them. They fought through. They figured out this way that is almost somewhat comical, but it's clearly, we sometimes speak about thinking outside of the box. That's one of the answers outside the box is, how do you see Christ? Well, we're going to climb over the roof and open it and let our friend down. Much of our time, our obstacles aren't really even on that level. Not even crowding, not even the day-to-day issues that we deal with, but quite frankly, oftentimes our biggest obstacle is a warm bed and a comfortable pillow. Sometimes it's hard to drag yourself out of bed on Sunday morning. And so these times that we have to be a little bit harsh with ourselves, that we have to be a little bit judgmental of ourselves. When somebody is at church, Bishop, the Metropolitan, the Pope, when he visits. I'm sure you've seen it when the Pope visits. And the Pope visits, everybody is here at 7. There's no parking. There's no place in the church. Everybody is crowded in. People are double parked. And yet every single Sunday, every liturgy, we have someone on the altar who is far, far more important than the Pope. When you even think about it, again, oftentimes we look at these obstacles in our lives and we really blow them completely out of proportion when it comes to our spiritual life. Every other aspect of our life, obstacles are something you overcome and you take pride in overcoming them. But somehow, when it's related to your spiritual life, we kind of throw our hands up in the air very quickly. It's almost like thinking about your work. You think about your work and you go up, what do you do in the morning to get to work? Well, it's a huge chore. I get up wicked early. And if those of you who have children, I got to get the kids ready for school, maybe get their lunches, but definitely get their clothes, tuck in their homework, sign their homework. I sometimes miss my coffee. I sometimes miss breakfast. Then I get out of the house and then only to fight traffic for so long. And then finally, I get to work. All of these obstacles in the morning. Well, what's the solution? What do you do? Well, I don't know. What other solution can there be? I have to quit work. Or maybe I can see if I can go in like every other week. Or maybe once every 3 weeks or something. Because this day today, all of these obstacles in the morning, missing my coffee, fighting with traffic, it's just too much. Imagine if this was our attitude towards our day-to-day work. None of us have this attitude about our day-to-day work. And I realize I'm kind of preaching at the choir this morning. You all are here. But we have a lot of empty pews this morning. To put in that little bit of effort. Imagine if those four men and their friend just kind of went around, turned around and went back home. they wouldn't have been blamed. They went, too difficult to see him, they went back home, but they would have never seen that miracle. They would have never seen their friend who's been lying there for who knows how long stand up, pick up that cot they brought him in on, and leave in front of the crowd. Christ tells them, I say to you, arise, take up your bed, and go to your home. It is that bed. That bed, you have to think about that bed. That bed is basically the symbol of everything that was wrong with the man. Christ doesn't just tell him, arise and go home. He tells him, arise, take up that bed. Carry it in front of everybody. Almost parade it in front of everybody and go back home. Take that symbol of everything that was wrong with you. Take that symbol of everything that limited you. You are now cured. You can now, it doesn't become a symbol of how limited you are. It becomes to you at home as a trophy. Now you can put it at the side of your bed, of your home. And always remember the day that the Lord visited you. The crowd, they could not come near him because of the crowd. Many mingling outside. A lot of them, as you heard in the account, are Pharisees. They were just kind of there again to test. They don't quite get Christ. Some are spectators. God forbid that we be part of the crowd. We are the ones who are there with a purpose. We are the ones who are coming to see Christ in spite of crowds, whether they be physical, mental, personal, whatever these crowds are. Carriers, these four friends of the man, and the fathers, they comment often on them. What are these four friends? And many interpret them as the four gospels bringing humanity to Christ. And the words of the gospels do bring us to Christ. We can also think of them as the sacraments: baptism, chrismation, communion, repentance, and then repeat. Every act of repentance, tears of repentance, our new baptism, the fervency of repentance, as the Holy Spirit works through you to repent, the Holy Spirit brings its fire, brings a new chrismation. And we have to kind of make at least a small note of these friends, because where does one find these friends? These four friends who are carrying their buddy. And four of them. You got to keep in mind that they're not paid to carry him. And it's not like the week before they're thinking, well, you know, I had to move, and I asked Bob to help me move the couch, and he came, and now he needs me, so I kind of feel obligated. It's not that sort of thing. Sincere friends who simply want to help out their comrade who cannot help himself. We have to bring each other to church. We have to bring ourselves to church. Again, oftentimes it's the crowds, the obstacles that stop us. There's so many things. There's working late. There's getting the kids ready in the morning. Sometimes there's the big game is on. Sometimes it's every little distraction that the devil and ourselves can bring to bear. Whether it's liturgy running too long, too short, because each of those is a distraction of its own. The hymns are on key, they're off key, they said this right, they said this wrong, the sermon is good, the sermon is bad, the sermon is horrible. All of these are distractions. Good and bad sermon thing, because really sermons are absolutely predicated on the hearer, not the one who delivers them. You know, I told you the story before about my very worst sermon, but I'm going to bug you with it again. Because this is the one that really taught me that sermons are not at all about the person delivering the sermon, it's about the hearer. What are you here to hear? What are you here to see? Whom are you here to encounter? Is it Christ, or is it to be entertained, to be amused, so on and so forth? But my very, very worst sermon, I was probably third, maybe fourth year after ordination. Going up, I knew it was a bad sermon. Sometimes you kind of feel it in your bones. This is going to be decent. This one was going to be bad. This was going to be bad. Going up to the Mangalaya, it was going to be a bad sermon. Up at the Mangalaya, delivering the sermon, my internal monologue. This is the worst sermon I've ever delivered. I'm embarrassed to be delivering this sermon. I remember continuing with my mental internal monologue, thinking, okay, we're going to cut this short because this is painful for me. This is clearly painful for them. Where it's painful for everybody. We're going to cut this short. Walking back, I was serving with Abuna Mina back then. Hopefully he doesn't remember this. But in my mind, I'm thinking, if Abuna Mina never asked me to give another sermon, perfectly fine. I should decline from here on out. No more sermons. This is horrible. This is atrocious. Can't be worse. The end of the liturgy, as we're leaving, somebody comes up to me and starts telling me what a great sermon it was, how it moved them, how wonderful it was. And I'm thinking, well, this is another one of our Coptic community who clearly excels in sarcasm. I follow the joke, I follow the point, and I am reacting. Then halfway, I'm realizing this person is being quite sincere. They got tears in their eyes. They were sincerely moved by this awful, awful sermon. Now, this was my third or fourth year after ordination. I've been at this now for over 19 years. Not one other sermon in those 19 years has ever moved anybody to tears. The worst sermon, as it turns out, that I've ever delivered was the best one ever. It's the only one that really had that desired effect. But it had nothing to do with me, the person giving the sermon. In my reckoning until today, that's the worst sermon I've ever given. And you've been with me for a while. There's a couple of other contenders in there, probably. But it is because of the individual and God working to the individual. The individual, each of us, keeping our ears, keeping our hearts open to God. Because when you come seeking God, if you seek, you will find, regardless of the hymns being on tune, the sermon being good or bad or what have you. Sometimes we get caught up, way too caught up in kind of what do I say? What do I do? What do I pray? And sometimes we kind of go into obsess over some of the trivial things, like, well, do I do one matanya? Do I do 10? Do I do 100? Would 1,000 suffice? What do I do? Here, look at the gospel of this morning. The gospel of this morning, the entire thing is predicated upon Christ seeing their faith. They came, they were seen by Christ, and Christ saw their faith. We just have to be seen by God. We have to elevate our hearts and our minds to God. It doesn't have to be long. I don't have to. If you have the time, you have the inclination, great, do the full hour of the Agbeya. But if you're in car and you're stuck on the 405, at the very least, you can lift your heart to God for a minute. You can pray a short psalm that you've memorized, or even if not the whole psalm, just a couple of verses. Just checking in, saying, God, I am here. Show me your glory, show me your person. We look at the sick man. We look at the sick man. We see a wonderful exchange, and it's an exchange that we all have to keep in mind on many different levels. The sick man, the cripple, the one who could not move at all, he still had faith. He still had faith. Otherwise, you know, he wouldn't let his friends just abduct him, basically, and take him. He had faith. He wanted to go to Christ. On one level, on the theological level, this is an extremely important exchange to keep in mind. Christ sees him, forgives him his sins. The Pharisees begin to quickly question, why is he blaspheming? Who can forgive sins except God alone? And Christ, to double down, basically asks him the rhetorical question, what is easier? Tell him forgive his sins or tell him to rise up and walk? And of course, from the human perspective, there's one answer. From God's perspective, it's another. In order for his sins to be completely forgiven, Christ is looking forward to the cross. Much more difficult to say your sins are forgiven than it is to rise up, be physically healed, and move on. But it's crucial here because they accuse him of blasphemy. He does not correct them. He does not back down. He does not pray. He does not intercede. He just simply forgives the sin, answering their very question. Who can forgive sin except God alone? Well, if Christ can forgive the sin, then Christ is God. This is fundamental because this is from the Gospel of St. Mark. This is the first gospel written. One of the things that you'll find in every documentary out there, every college class, everything that deals with Christianity is this notion that there's a development in this idea. At the beginning, Jesus was kind of a rabbi, and then you have the Christ of faith, and you have books, documentaries with that exact title, with that exact idea, so on and so forth. They'll tell you, look at John and how explicit the divinity is in the Gospel of John. Here, the very first gospel, second chapter, and we can even go before that, but the morning's readings is from the second chapter. It's clear as daylight. Who can forgive sins except God? Why is he blaspheming? Because Christ is God. It's also important for us to keep this miracle in mind for our spiritual lives. Often we are kind of looking for the fantastic. Where is God? Why don't I see God? Why don't I encounter God? We're looking for miracles in our lives, but we're not looking for the everyday miracles. We're not looking for God's providence. We're not looking for his mercy. These are things that we kind of routinely take for granted. We're kind of looking for the spectacular. We're looking kind of for our own parting of the Red Sea sort of thing. I want to see the light, hear the thunder, and the parting of the waters. But again, when we look closely at the miracle of this morning, we have to be reminded that what was said by Christ at another point, that many kings and prophets have tried to see what you see and have not seen, have tried to hear what you heard and have not heard. This man is told, your sins are forgiven. We take this completely for granted because we constantly hear about it being forgiven. All of our prayers that we're ending with, forgive our sins. But we have to understand that this remission of sins, this is miraculous. This is something that took from the time of Adam until Christ on the cross and in the tomb and out of the tomb in order to accomplish. Everything in the Old Testament is a symbol. Nothing really forgave sin. What forgives sin is this sacrifice of Christ. Kings and prophets tried to see and tried to hear what you heard and did not hear. What is it that this man heard that David, that Solomon, that Moses never heard? What is it this morning that we've heard that David, Solomon, Abraham, Isaac, all the greats of the Old Testament never heard? What is it that we hear that is miraculous, that is different, that entire generations lived and died and never heard? And it's quite simple. Your sins are forgiven. Go and sin no more. Glory be to God.
Can you know?